She had some contact with the white school downtown. One block, paved block. And she would come up the road carrying these books. And I knew they were from me. The most amazing thing. And I would get into the books and be free, amazing freedom of my own psychological problems and my memory, free of racism, just random, and free. So, when over the years, and during poetry in those years, and I love it. Was 1 year before the main law. these are have been included in Alice Gillies' phenomenon, the book Roots, or in the television phenomenon Roots, in which I played Kunti's grandmother. To these are, I mean, here we are, still here. Today, upwards of 50 million, and there are people who swear that's it. Inconsequential estimate. Some people say there are more than 50 million black people in the Baptist church. And the three black atheists in the world. Still the butts of many white liberals' jokes, but still here. I suggest that the foot has been a light. Still is. Years ago, really, because when a number of non-black people write about sex and black people live and I just can't help but sigh. Seems like to me my throat me a tear stayed in my eye since she went there. Now that beautiful day that Gloria's gone, the birds have whispered to their mates alone, they're one with all the dead. Now that she is dead and gone. Oh, but the glory of the day was in her. Some years ago, I was invited to speak at the University of Minnesota in Minneapolis. And I went there, had a wonderful time. The people liked me, I liked them. And this is not a hint or anything, but they did invite me back 3 years later. There was a line of security, about 6 or 8 security people. So I went backstage and I sat on the stool, cooling my knees, when a woman came through the curtains. She reminded me of myself, except that she was fine. She's 6 foot tall and 6 foot. She had an air. I claim an air. She was about my age, which is what the French call a servant. She walked right through the security, as if they were copying my shirt. She walked right through, and I said, hello. She said, oh, I want to hug you. So I said, all right. We embraced. She said, I thank you for my daughter's life. She started to cry. I should. She said, her daughter had attempted suicide in a number of times. But 3 years earlier, someone had brought her daughter to hear me speak. And that night I had spoken over the courage to live. And, she cried, I cried. When we broke the embrace, a young woman came from stage right, looking just like her mom. You couldn't have made a mistake, except she was about 25 years. She came in, well, said thank you. The mother said, Cynthia, what are you doing here? She asked her. And the young woman said, and she lived in Eau Claire, Wisconsin, that she read that I was going to speak, so she'd driven over. So the mother hugged the girl hugged me, I hugged the mother. We had a good time. And when they prepared to leave, the mother gave me a letter. She said, I want you to have this letter. My daughter wrote to me after having heard you speak. So they took their leave, and I was on a tour, so I didn't return home for about 3 weeks. When I did, I opened the letter, and it broke my heart. It was rife with ignorance, racism, and just, she said, in effect, mother, I went to hear my I remember consistently. My life may have pulled such promise to someone else, and even for myself. And you know that. She said, but before I tell you what she said, let me tell you how she looked. She came onto the stage, she was so big, and so black, and so ugly. Mother, she terrified me. Her voice was so big. Twinkling down, and then they were running down. But I knew that I was moaning and blubbering. We lived together in varying degrees of intimacy for almost 400 years, and you mean to tell me this girl who can say it has been a part of saving her life found me terrifying? And I thought, oh my God, I finally thought, really, trying to pull myself together because if I don't, I was trying to think about suicide.
She said, you've endangered every
person in here.
Thank you.